Hello, I'm Alex. I'm one of the colorectal clinical oncology consultants, and I'm going to talk to you today about colorectal cancer. So today we're going to go through these areas in the talk, starting with epidemiology. Here you can see that over 42,000 patients a year are diagnosed with colorectal cancer in the UK, and that equates to around about 1 in 20 patients. Here the stats are broken down by survival, both by colon cancer and rectal cancer, and you can see the 1 year survival is very good, around about 75 to 80%, and that the 5 year survival is around 60%. So this slide just shows that this is commoner, the colorectal cancer is commoner in males, and that the incidence increases with age. This slide just shows that our mortality rates are reducing over time as we have better treatments and also more effective screening programs. This slide shows the staging for colorectal cancer, and you can see that by stage, the T stage is broken up by how far through the tumour goes through the bowel wall. And I think this slide is really nice to show the detail of this, and then you can read the nodal staging is based on the number of nodes involved, so that you can see the metastasis stage is broken down again by organ and site. This slide shows that the outcomes, survival outcomes, are affected by the stage of the cancer that is picked up. And as you can see, very early cancers, the prognosis is excellent, whereas as you get to stage 4 cancers, the prognosis is much, much worse at 5 years. And here, this is another way of breaking down the survival outcomes based on stage. And all these images are taken from the Cancer Research UK website that has really good statistics on all cancers. So next we'll talk about pathogenesis. Here you can see that the progression from polyps through to malignant cancers, and this is shown at the bottom in a histological specimen, where you can see the really nicely round demarcated polyps in comparison to the invasive tumour. Here you can see that the tumours are actually more common in the left side of the colon and the rectum. So about a third of patients will have their cancer diagnosed within the rectum, a third on the left-hand side of the bowel, and then the remaining side of the bowel is another third. And that's an easy way to be able to remember this. Now we're going to move on to a case presentation to try and help you remember. So this patient, Mr. FB, is a retired fireman, and he presents with a 3-month history of rectal bleeding, intermittent constipation, and some abdominal pain. Now, the question I'd be asking you is, how many red flag symptoms do you think he has? So here you can see that all three of those symptoms are red flag symptoms. On this slide here, you can see a list of all the red flag symptoms that you should be thinking about when you're taking a history from somebody who may a concern may have colorectal cancer. And they're broken down into the local symptoms and also the more systemic symptoms of cancer. So to highlight here, a really common symptom that patients might present with is rectal bleeding. Around about 50% of the population will have rectal bleeding at some point. It accounts for quite a common symptom for patients to talk about with their GPs, and only a small proportion of those will actually be diagnosed with rectal cancer. The other causes for PR bleeding are listed there for you to think about in your differential diagnoses. So carrying on in your history, you find out about past medical history and family history as key things to think about in your history taking, and in this case he's fit and well and has no family history. On examination, his abdomen is soft and non-tender, and he has no masses on PR examination. So other things to look for on examination are listed here. So systemic signs of cancer in terms of anemia and weight loss as well. And so what would you do next is the question. You would be thinking about how you would like to refer this patient into secondary care for further investigation. So in this case, you'd be worried about this patient potentially having a malignant process going on, so they'd be referred through an urgent referral service. This patient's fit and well, so you could refer them for a straight to test, which means they would go and have either a colonoscopy or a flexible sigmoidoscopy initially. Or if their patient was less fit and you were worried about sending them straight to a test, you could send them refer them into the colorectal team for assessment within 2 weeks. If a patient is found to have cancer, then their treatment should start within 62 days of the of referral. About a quarter of patients are referred as a normal outpatient, and another quarter are admitted as emergency presentations. And these patients often present with much more advanced cancers, presenting with obstruction and perforation. So screening accounts for another about 10% of patients who are picked up with colorectal cancer. Now we've moved, as of January of last year, to doing fecal immunohistochemistry testing, which requires a single stool sample to be sent through for testing. And this replaces the previous fecal occult blood testing, which required three samples, stool samples to be sent through. If those patients are found to have a positive test, then they are then sent for further investigation, so a colonoscopy and assessment by the colorectal team. The other thing that has been brought in recently is that patients aged 55 will have a single flexible sigmoidoscopy to try and pick up premalignant polyps. If that is a normal scope, however, those patients will then go back into the normal FIT testing screening route. So our patient went on to have a colonoscopy, and he was found to have a tumour at 7 centimetres from the anal verge. And you can see quite nicely on this picture the difference between the tumour and the normal healthy mucosa. This patient will also, at the point of colonoscopy, have a biopsy, and this confirmed adenocarcinoma. So other further investigations that this patient will have is a CT as a staging process. So that will be a CT abdomen, pelvis and chest. This patient, you can see really nicely on the image on the right, the tumour, the rectal tumour, and the patient had no metastases seen on the rest of his imaging. So the definitive imaging for a rectal cancer patient is an MRI of the rectum, and this is because the soft tissue is much better defined on MRI than CT. And here you can see the vascular invasion labelled, the nodal disease labelled, and you can also see how far the tumour extends outside of the muscular wall. This makes this patient staging a T3, N1, V1, which is the vascular invasion, M0, mid-rectal cancer of the rectum. And here we are also looking at the involvement of the circumferential resection margin, which is the CRM, and that is the plane at which the surgeons will resect around to ensure that the tumour is completely removed. I will go back and talk about this at a later slide, as you can see that the involvement of the margin actually really affects the way in which we treat patients up front. So this is the final information that you have. Also important to note at MDT is that the patient is fit and well, no significant comorbidities. This will obviously affect how you treat the patient. So at MDT, everyone turns to you as the clinical oncologist to ask what you would like to do next. So have a little think. This slide summarises the treatment processes for the different patients. Now, this patient is at moderate risk of local recurrence. So rectal cancers are more commonly locally recurrent than colon cancers, and that's why the radiotherapy is involved as a treatment to be able to use to reduce local recurrence. Now, we give this treatment before surgery as a way of either treating the area that is going to be resected to try and reduce local recurrence in the moderate risk patients, or in patients which are high risk, so those patients we define as those which in which the CRM is involved, as I mentioned on the previous slide, those patients we want to try and shrink the tumour down before they have surgery. And that's where we will treat with a different course of radiotherapy combined with chemotherapy over 5 weeks. In comparison to this patient who is moderate risk, who we would treat with 5 fractions of radiotherapy followed by surgery within a week after completing treatment. Low risk patients go straight for surgery. Colon cancer is slightly different. Generally, all patients with colon cancer will go straight to surgery. However, there's been some recent trials that have shown that patients who have locally advanced colon cancer, so T4 or node positive disease, might actually benefit from chemotherapy prior to surgery. The next slide describes the trial Foxtrot, which looked at this in detail and compares giving chemotherapy as a bit of a sandwich treatment before surgery and then followed by following surgery versus chemotherapy all after surgery. And what it found that giving treatment before surgery was actually safe and effective, managed to downstage the tumour before surgical resection, and also meant that the surgical resection margin, the what we measure as an R0 resection rate, was much higher. After his neoadjuvant radiotherapy followed by immediate surgery, this patient's case was then discussed again at the multidisciplinary team meeting, the MDT, and his final histology was a T3, N2, V1, R0, so a clear resection, M0. So then we are asked at MDT what you would like to do next, and then there's a discussion about the role of adjuvant chemotherapy in these patients. So the role of adjuvant chemotherapy in rectal cancer patients is less clear than the role for adjuvant chemotherapy in colon patients. The detail is complicated, but broadly those patients who are more high risk, so in this case patients who have nodal disease, we would consider thinking about the role of chemotherapy. He's fit and well, he has no other comorbidities, and so the benefit in this case is likely to be greater than somebody who is frail and old. So this is, we have a discussion about all patients who have neoadjuvant radiotherapy treatment in this way. Often the discussion is around any complexity of the case in terms of making decisions about the next steps of treatment in terms of the role of adjuvant chemotherapy. So in this case, this patient is fit and well, and he does have some high-risk features for distant cancer recurrence, and so he was offered adjuvant chemotherapy. There are two options here, either single agent chemotherapy or dual agent chemotherapy, and these again are based on the risk factors and also the age of the patient and comorbidity status. In the past we used to give this chemotherapy for 6 months, but now we only give it for 3 months based on the results of the SCOT trial. The other additional important piece of information is since September of last year, we've actually been routinely testing patients for a sensitivity for the 5-FU-based chemotherapy. This is an enzyme deficiency called DPD. Patients who have the deficiency actually get a much more severe reaction to the chemotherapy as they're unable to metabolize it. So it's really exciting that we're able to bring this in for all patients now to try and predict those patients who are more likely to get side effects of chemotherapy treatment. So in terms of follow-up schedules, this is managed by the colorectal surgical team. It's mainly telephone-based and specialist nurse-led. They have 6 monthly CEAs as a tumour marker for a recurrence. They also have intermittent CT staging investigations, and they have a complete colonoscopy if they haven't had one already within 12 months, and then they have another one 3 years after that. At his follow-up appointment, 12 months after completing his treatment, he was found to have a raised CEA, otherwise fit and well. At this point, he had further investigation in the form of a CT scan. The CT scan unfortunately showed that he had a single lesion seen within his liver, which is pointed out with an arrow. Further investigation revealed that this was a liver metastasis, so what would you do next? So this case was brought back to the MDT, and at this point you can make a decision about what you think would be the next best treatment option. So this case, he has oligometastatic disease, so he had one metastasis in one place. So actually, we're increasingly treating these patients more radically. So in this case, we would consider quite a focused approach with using a surgical treatment to resect that liver metastasis, and actually the outcomes are very good with 5-year survival rates of around 40%. However, unfortunately, this gentleman, 6 months later, had a much higher raised CEA, and on his staging imaging was found to have multiple lung metastases and also spinal metastasis. So this case is now definitively palliative in treatment. This patient has multiple metastatic disease, and the most important thing to think about in this case is treating the patient systemically. So there are two key options here, either to do nothing, so to not treat, or to think about giving some systemic chemotherapy. So no treatment means would be just to give best supportive care to support with palliative interventions, and some patients will opt for this treatment option, and the prognosis is around about 6 to 9 months after a diagnosis of multiple metastatic colorectal cancer. Offering systemic chemotherapy is done in patients who are symptomatic, and the life expectancy is much improved to around about 18 months to 2 years. However, this comes at the cost of multiple treatment visits, toxicity, and all the complexity of having chemotherapy. So some patients do opt not to have this treatment. So finally, I want to talk to you about the recent developments in colorectal cancer, so you can see where the field is moving. So this is the update on the Foxtrot trial that I mentioned earlier. This is looking to see if we can be more specific and selective about the patients who we treat with this chemotherapy regime. So one of the most interesting things that came out was that patients actually often didn't manage to have their chemotherapy after their surgery. And this was actually commoner in patients who were older and frailer. And so this led to the question as to whether patients who are older and frailer could actually benefit from having their chemotherapy upfront before they have their surgery, so that they actually get some chemotherapy treatment in, rather than never having any chemotherapy treatment at all. The other question is whether or not it can be we can improve the outcomes by increasing the amount of chemotherapy, so adding three agents rather than two agents for patients who are young and fit, to see whether or not that could actually improve longer term outcomes. Finally, in rectal cancer, the questions are all around whether or not you can preserve your rectal organ. So you can imagine in patients who are young and fit, who have early rectal cancer that's picked up, for example, through screening, the thought of having major surgery, particularly a surgery that may end up in having a stoma, seems rather daunting and actually difficult to consider. So the trials at the moment that are going on in the UK are this, and also the Netherlands, is the Star Trek trial, which is looking at this very question, which is asking patients if they would prefer to try and opt for an organ preservation route and have radiotherapy followed by microsurgery if they need it for any residual disease, as compared to major surgical treatment. And this trial is running at the moment. So those, I've wanted to present that to you so you know what the big questions are in colorectal cancer at the current time. Finally, thank you very much for listening. And if you have any questions, please feel free to email me.